Hi, welcome to FOMAS Solutions. If you are about to watch my tutorial for the first time, let me say you have mixed a lot of things. See, we have had series of discussions as far as the course introductory analysis is concerned. We've talked about real number system. We went on and talked about types of proofs, proof by contradiction, proof by mathematical induction. We saw several examples. Interesting concepts have been discussed. And so you need to get running, look for our tutorials and begin to watch to help you in your discussions and in your course. Right. Good, but in this tutorial, I want to look at one interesting aspect of introductory analysis, that is the properties of limits of sequence. So let's look at properties. Properties of limits of sequence. Okay. Alright, properties of limits of sequence. So, one of the properties is that on the property of uniqueness, the uniqueness of limits. Limits of sequence. Now when you say the limit of a sequence is unique, what exactly are we at? And the limits of a sequence is unique. So for convergent sequences, realize that the limit is only one. So it's actually a theory which says that for any convergent limit, then it has at most one limit. So in other words, you can say that for a sequence to be unique, that means that it has its limits being equal to a certain value. No other value, no any strange other value. We have the limits of the sequence. So if we have this sequence, for instance, that means that its limit as n approaches infinity is equal to e. And when we have something like this, it means that the limits of the sequence is unique. It is only this value and no other value. But we want to prove this. Okay, we can't just say that it's like this and we go and say, okay, we are okay. But we want to prove this particular property of limit of sequence. So we're doing this by one of the proofs. That's why it is important that you look for our previous videos and watch where we talk about proof by contradiction. So we're going to use proof by contradiction. So by contradiction. So you're going to use proof by contradiction to actually show that the limits of this sequence, or any convergent sequence, is unique. Alright, so you recall that in proof by contradiction, we need to start with negative statements, also the negative of the statement. So here the statement you're looking at is that the limits of the sequence is unique. So you start by saying that the limit of the sequence is not unique. And when it's not unique, it means that the limit of this particular sequence as n approaches infinity is equal to e. And you are also saying that the limit of the same sequence as n approaches infinity is equal to b. That presupposes that you are telling us that the limit, this particular limit, as n approaches infinity, is having two values, a and b, and that a is not equal to b. So they are not the same, a and b are not the same. And you're also saying that a is greater than b. Right. So you're saying that a is greater than b, such that when we subtract a from b and find its absolute, you see that it's going to be greater than. It's going to be greater than zero. Right. So this is the negative proposition we are looking at, and that the limit of this particular sequence is not unique; it has different values. So moving on from here, we realize that can look at this particular one. So picking this one alone, you will see that given any epsilon positive, so given epsilon greater than zero, you say that there exists a certain n. Now because here we are looking at, see the sequence seems to have been splitted. We have 1 year, another 1 year approaching different values. So you say that as n1, so there exists n1 which belongs to the set of natural numbers. So the set of natural numbers such that for all n greater than n1, we're going to have the absolute of this particular sequence, which is less minus e, way less than what epsilon. Now, similarly, what we have here, then we are able to say that, okay, given, so for this particular case, we say that given epsilon greater than zero, so there exists, so in this case, you want to say n2, which belongs to the set of natural numbers, such that for all n greater than n2, then we're going to have the absolute of the sequence minus, now the limit here is b, so the sequence minus the limit, which is b, is also going to be less than epsilon. Now because we now have n1 and n2, then we must use the maximum of the two. So in the let n be equal to the maximum of n1, right, and n2. Okay, so for all n greater than, that's more n greater than what? Big N. Alright, so we are setting the tone for the major proof. Now, at this point, we need to go back to our negative proposition, which is telling us that the absolute of A minus B is greater than zero. Alright, so we're going to pick that, so we pick this aspect of it. So we say that absolute of A minus B is here. So if we take the absolute of A minus B, then it can be equal to, so we come here and say that, look at A, saying that the limit of this particular sequence as n approaches infinity is equal to A. And its equivalent statement is given as this. And at the end, we say that we should have absolute of A, that's absolute of the fun of the sequence minus its limit being less than that. So it means that we can bring the absolute number. So in place of A, we write the sequence minus its limit. Then what sign we have, the sign we have here is negative sign, or the minus sign, so we have minus, then we move on. So looking at B, here we say that the limit of this particular sequence as n approaches infinity equals B. And its equivalent statement resulted in this. So we can use this in place of B in this particular proof. So we have in here the sequence n minus B. So we have in this. So we have in all that. Okay. So we have here the absolute of A minus of B. Now, you realize that at this point, we are told that the absolute of A minus B will be greater than zero. It also means that zero is going to be less than the absolute of A minus B. Okay, so here we can say that zero is less than the absolute of A minus B. Then we say that this is equal to, we here we can rewrite this as this minus E. Then when we come here, realize that this multiply this and give a negative. Then this and this gives us positive. So we have in here negative E in the sequence, then plus B. all over there. And so we want to move on by applying a certain concept we call triangle inequality. Triangle inequality. Right, so if you are hearing triangle inequality for the first time, for instance, if you have a triangle in this form, and so it doesn't matter the type of triangle, then the triangle inequality is saying that, alright, so the length of one side, so for instance, if this place is z, and we are having this place to be maybe x, okay, so you have y here and x here, we are the size. Then the triangle inequality is saying that the sum of these two sides is always going to be greater than this particular side. Or in other words, it's saying that z, so z here is going to be equal to, so we're going to have z, so for instance, we are finding the average of z, then we should be getting something less than the average of x plus the average of y. So that is all about the triangle inequality. So that's what we're trying to apply here. So when we come here, realize that we have this entity here, this entity to here. So we say that 0 is less than a minus b, that's the average of that. So by triangle inequality, we say that the average of a minus e, right, so it's absolute plus. So because we are using triangle inequality, so that the equality sign here wouldn't be appropriate. So we say that this should be less than. Alright. Or so we have less than this. Then we are in plus the absolute of, we have minus sign here and plus b. We have something of that selection. Alright, so we have that. Then we have 0 less than a minus b, so less than. Alright, so here we don't have any problem with it. We have less minus a. But we realize that here we're trying to get something similar to this. But here, this one, we don't have any problem with it because it's looking like this already. But when we come here, say that we have a negative. So we negate everything in the absolute symbol. When this place is negated, everything is negated, this one becomes positive and this becomes negative. So that at the end we get something like this. And this, then one is no b. So we have something like that. Alright, so let's continue. Now from here we realize that we're saying that all this is less than epsilon and all this one too is less than epsilon. So we can substitute that for this and that. So that we have 0 less than the absolute of a minus b, which is also less than. So in place of this we have epsilon. And in place of this one too we have epsilon, so we have epsilon plus epsilon. So this gives us 0 less than the absolute of a minus b. Then we have this less than. So this and this gives us 2 epsilon. Alright, so here we look at it this way. We have the absolute of a minus b, which is less than epsilon. And epsilon in itself is a very small number. Very much close to 0, almost 0, and here is 0. So you look at absolute of a minus b is in between all 0 and a value which is very close to 0. So if you want to take the value of a minus b, one could say that it is almost 0. So we say that a, the absolute of a minus b is equal to 0. So in effect we say that that's a minus b. So a minus b is equal to 0. So on this basis, you say a is equal to b. Now realize that here we are saying a is equal to b. But in our negative proposition, we made the point that a was not equal to what? To b. Right, so at this point, you see that we are contradicting our negative proposition. So in here we are concluding that A is equal to B. But earlier we said that A shouldn't be equal to B, and that's conflicting. So we said that then it is not appropriate for us to say that A is not equal to B. Then we will now conclude that A equals B, and that the limit of A as n approaches infinity is equal to E, and the limit of this as n approaches infinity equals B, that means A is equal to B. It means that the value of A is the same as the value of B, and if that is the case, then the limit of this particular sequence is unique. So that is our proof. Thanks very much for taking part in this tutorial. You will get more of this if you like our YouTube page, subscribe, and comment on whatever we are doing. Thanks very much for watching. Bye.